This vodcast is part of the Health Communication Management Workshop of the eHealth Faculty Development Series, sponsored by the Association of Faculties of Medicine of Canada and Canada Health InfoWay. The workshop organizers and presenters declare no conflicts of interest. In the workshop, we discuss a number of issues, including technologies that affect communication with patients and within the healthcare team, professional handling of email, text messaging and video conferencing, and the implications for practice of patients communicating with other patients on social media. In this vodcast, we focus on the topic of using email to communicate with patients. According to the 2014 National Physician Survey of Canadian Physicians, 12% of physicians reported using email to communicate with patients about chronic conditions. The vast majority of people use email for general communication, not related to patients. The way we use electronic tools like email professionally requires far more consideration than the way we use them personally. Physicians are well aware of their legal and moral obligations to protect patient health information, but they also need to be aware of the specific privacy risks inherent in the use of electronic communication tools such as email. In general, people use email because it is fast and convenient. However, the benefits may be outweighed by the risks unless appropriate precautions are taken. There are a few questions you might want to ask yourself while watching this vodcast. Does your staff communicate with patients via email? Do your residents or medical students communicate with patients via email? Do your residents and medical students use a secure email account, hospital-based, for example, to communicate with or about patients, or an insecure account like Yahoo or Gmail? If anyone on your healthcare team is using email to communicate with patients, do patients sign a consent form about the use of email first? There is tremendous interplay between many factors in determining the actual implications for practice. As an example, even something as simple as sending an email is affected by many of these. Firstly, there are governing bodies that make recommendations or guidelines about how to use email professionally, and often multiple different guidelines, including local hospital policies. Secondly, there are the technical aspects of sending the email securely. Issues affecting how it is sent, the security of the email servers at both sending and receiving ends, and security of the mobile device or laptop it is being sent from. There are numerous stakeholders and regulatory bodies that provide guidance, and they can be broken down into national, provincial, and local categories. Most physicians will have obligations at all of these levels. For example, a physician working in a teaching hospital would be obligated to consider recommendations from the CMPA, their national regulatory body, like the College of Family Physicians or Royal College, their provincial privacy commissioner and professional college, as well as their local hospital policies. Given that this is a national audience, we will focus on national recommendations. However, participants should check their provincial and local regulations as well. Unfortunately, the various guidelines do not all agree in terms of their recommendations. For example, the Privacy Commissioner's Office in Ontario allows use of email for limited personal health information through an unencrypted email address if the patient signs an explicit consent form. However, the Privacy Commissioner in Alberta does not condone use of unencrypted email at all, regardless of whether or not a consent form has been signed. The Colleges of Physicians and Surgeons of Alberta and Ontario take a stricter position and recommend that doctors use only secure and encrypted emails to communicate with patients and avoid unsecured email communication altogether. This is just one example, and you are strongly encouraged to check your own jurisdictional requirements. The legal issues pertaining to electronic communications are universal across the various types of communication, including confidentiality, privacy, and security. There are additional legal issues to be aware of when using email to communicate with patients, including timeliness and clarity. For timeliness, patients should be informed that they are responsible for following up on emails, and a target turnaround may be established. For example, if a patient hasn't received a response within 48 hours, they should call the office. Furthermore, patients need to be advised not to use email for urgent medical issues. In terms of clarity of communication, the onus is on the physician not to use acronyms and medical jargon, and physicians should keep in mind that it is difficult to communicate wit, humor, and sensitivity in email. What are the ethical issues we need to consider when using email? Email is very convenient, which is why both patients and physicians like it. However, it is not secure. Messages can inadvertently go to the wrong recipient due to a typo in the email address, change in someone's email address, or their email account being hacked. Even with the correct email address, the sender has no idea who is viewing the recipient's messages. For example, many people have their email set up to automatically pop up on the computer when a new message arrives. However, the sender has no way of knowing who is using the computer at a given time at the receiver's end. It could be the patient's spouse, parent, or child. Furthermore, patients may not realize that an employer could access their emails if they use a work email account. Although physicians or the institutions they work for often add disclaimers at the bottom of an email, such a disclaimer does not negate the physician's responsibility to protect patient health information. Email should not be used to convey time-sensitive information, as emails can arrive hours or days after the message is sent, and the receiving party may not review incoming messages in a timely manner. Lastly, all communications with patients should be kept in the patient's medical record. When using email, it involves additional work to get these emails into the patient chart. As mentioned previously, we will discuss national recommendations and guidelines for the purposes of this podcast. The Canadian Medical Protective Association, or CMPA, has issued recommendations on many electronic communications methods, including use of email with patients. Please bear in mind that these are recommendations only and should not be viewed as mandatory. What does the CMPA suggest? Firstly, physicians should understand the legal risks associated in communication by email with patients. Before engaging in email communication, members should review any applicable statutory and college requirements that may impact the use of email for transmitting patient health information. Patients should be aware of the potential risks and agree to assume those risks. A signed consent form that outlines the risk of email communication, as well as the obligations placed on patients who wish to correspond via email, provides a permanent record of the consent given and should be considered. The CMPA does provide a template consent form on their website that can be used to obtain patient consent. Lastly, physicians should implement policies and procedures for handling email communication. For example, if a parent or legal guardian's email address is used to communicate about a child's health issues, there should be a policy in place to revoke that email consent at a certain age so the parent isn't still receiving emails when the child becomes a young adult. Putting such processes in place may adversely affect workflow and in some cases negate the perceived benefits of using email in the first place. Collecting email consent from each patient is a time-consuming process and can be challenging to manage and keep current. Physicians and other healthcare team members may not all have access to a secure, encrypted email account. A process needs to be in place for ensuring email messages get into the patient's permanent record. Anecdotally, many physicians are using email to communicate with patients without sufficient consideration of existing recommendations. What is the educational impact of all this? For the most part, our learners know about privacy settings and issues to consider for personal use of email, but they are not as well versed about the professional implications and how to negotiate these boundaries. Currently, there is a broad spectrum of how faculty use technology, ranging from those who don't use it at all to those who are using it well, but not always with appropriate safeguards in place. Now that you know what the national recommendations are regarding use of email, do you feel your current practice is in compliance? Are you confident that your learners are following current recommendations as well? In summary, it is imperative that you familiarize yourself with national as well as provincial and local jurisdictional guidelines for use of email. If you are planning to communicate with patients via email, you should ensure that there are appropriate policies in place at your workplace to ensure safe use of email, which may include a signed consent from patients. In the toolkit for the workshop, you will find references to help guide you in finding appropriate resources.